I introduce the first speaker of the session, Dr. Praveen Kumar Vemula. He is a faculty at the Institute for Stem Cell Biology and Regenerative Medicine, InStem, Bangalore. His work spans the field of biomaterials, drug delivery, medical devices, and chemical biology. Several technologies developed his lab has formed the foundation for multiple products on the market and currently under development. His technology led to the launch of four companies, includes Sapio Health, Ortis Therapeutics, and Alivio Therapeutics. His area of interest includes self-assembled pro-drug-based nanomaterials, next-generation biomaterials, inflammation-responsive hydrogels, and nanomaterials. Let's move on to Dr. Praveen Kumar Vemula's talk.
You about like how we can use the design of nanomaterials for biomedical applications, especially like some of the concepts what we have been developing, like disease responsive nanomaterials for biomedical applications. So I'm a faculty at the Institute for Stem Cell Biology and Regenerative Medicine, which is located. My lab is focused on the clinical translation research, and where we run two programs parallelly. One is like a biomaterials and chemical biology program. And we take like a two approaches to solve our problems. One is technology push upward. This is mostly the fundamental research where we use the chemical design of small molecules. These are like, you know, small molecule amplifiers, lipid-like molecules. By modulating the chemical structures, we can direct them to form various kinds of nanomaterials. So by understanding this basic research, like we try to take that knowledge and apply for the medical applications. The second approach what we take is the clinical full approach, where hereby like first we identify an unmet clinical need, and then we custom design and develop specific technology to solve that particular problem. So the combination of these two approaches what we practice in laboratory, and typically as I said, like a biomaterials chemical biology program when we run, in the biomaterials we take the existing drugs, and then try to improve the efficacy of the existing drugs by eliminating all the side effects or the limitations they have today. And the chemical biology program, we try to develop the new chemical entities or the novel drugs. It's a drug discovery program. And typically, biomaterials can be divided into two, like as name suggests, is a therapeutic or prophylactic materials. So in the therapeutic biomaterials, like we design the materials to which can be used in a therapy. And whereas in the prophylactic biomaterials, we use for preventing the diseases even before they occur. In the chemical biology program, again, it can be divided into two, like either small molecular based drug discovery or the biologics based drug discovery. So to begin with, I quickly give the overview about the therapeutic biomaterials that could be used for medical applications. And we have been like focusing on developing materials for treatment of inflammatory disorders, because as we know, inflammation is the inherent part of majority of the diseases, like, you know, lupus, arthritis, psoriasis, and so on. And having very potent anti-inflammatory drugs, we still do not have very efficient therapeutic outcome for the treatment of these inflammatory disorders. Because the primary reason for this is like, if you see the inflammation, it's never like a steady state. Right, it's highly fluctuated. Like, for example, you have the increased state of inflammation, you have a steady state, you have remission period, occasional flare-ups, and so on. But unfortunately, we do not have a reliable, non-invasive diagnostic method to quantify the level of inflammation a patient has at any given point of time. Therefore, it becomes very difficult for the doctor to prescribe the right dose and the right time of the So we thought, like, if we can solve this problem, it can be used as a platform technology for treatment of, you know, series of inflammatory disorders. So if you step back and see the drug delivery, like the history of drug delivery in the past 70 years, there are two major breakthrough concepts that have been developed. One is like in the early stage, developing the excipient-based drug delivery system. These are like either small molecule or polymer-based excipient. But the given choice of your excipient and the drug formulations, if you give a single dose, it keeps the drug in a therapeutic window for a certain amount of time. When it goes to the subtherapeutic level, you give second dose and so on. That's how, like, you know, a doctor prescribes you whether you have to take a medication once and so on. So this is great, like, for when you have the short time therapy window, right? Like, where you can take medication for a few days to a week or so. But the chronic disorders where you have to take medication for several weeks to several months, without missing the dosage, it is impossible. Compliance issue comes. So to overcome that limitation, people have developed a sustained drug delivery material in the late 70s, where a variety of biomaterials are designed to encapsulate your drugs, and the single dose administration keep drug in a therapeutic window for a long period of time. So these two ways of delivering drugs has revolutionized the way you treat the patients. Right? But if you see the inflammatory disorders, as I mentioned, the level of disease itself highly fluctuated, right? In that case, delivering drugs either way, it's not efficient. Either you overdose the patients or underdose the patients. So ideal way of delivering drugs would be like having a mirror image to the inflammation, right? For example, whenever the disease comes, they should start releasing the drug. When disease goes down, they should stop. And if the flare-up comes, they should start releasing the drug. The question is, like, since we don't even know how to measure the inflammation, it's very difficult to design the materials which can have such profile, right? So this is only possible when disease itself controls the level of inflammation, or the level of inflammation should control the release of the drug. Then only this can happen. So that's the overall concept what we have been developing. How we do is, like, for example, you identify a specific biomarker that is overexpressed at the time of disease, right? So this could be a cytokine, protein, enzyme, so on, peptides and so on. Under normal condition, they shouldn't express, but when disease comes, they should overexpress. Now you develop the implantable drug delivery system. In the absence of biomarker, they don't release the drug, but when you disease occurs, if the biomarker comes, that should able to trigger the release of the drug. And the release drug goes and alleviates the disease, that stops the production of biomarker, that stops releasing of the drug. Only in this way one can design to develop this disease responsive biomaterials. And I'll show you how this concept could be used for multiple medical applications, like, you know, protecting transplanted organs or treatment of inflammatory arthritis and IBD cells and so on. So when you talk about the organ transplantation, you have two types, right? You have the solid organ transplantation, these are life-saving organ transplants. The second category is VCA, vascularized composite tissue organ transplantation. So particularly today, I'll talk about the hand transplantation. And as you know, like each color-coded part has already been transplanted. It's like, and as I mentioned today, I'll talk a little more about the hand transplantation. Like, now surgery techniques have developed so much that people can do single and double hand transplants very efficiently. And the post-transplantation, you know, people can gain the function of this organ and so on. But the question is everything is okay with these patients? And unfortunately, no. Because, as you know, like, our immune system is designed to identify foreign materials and neutralize them. In these patients, especially, it becomes like your enemy because your transplanted organ recognizes the foreign material that you try to reject. Because of that, these patients have to take immunosuppressant drugs throughout their life every single day. Right? So that leads to the entire global immunosuppression. They are like almost immunocompromised. Small infection could be highly lethal for these patients. So I think there is an urgent need to develop systems where you protect the transplanted organ without causing your system. So, and the question is how that can be done. And as I mentioned, like, this is, again, like, your immune activation and associated inflammation is highly fluctuated. And people have been trying to encapsulate these immunosuppressants in biomaterials and game. But unfortunately, as I mentioned, like, you know, the drug delivery profile is a classical biomaterial drug delivery profile, and which doesn't match, right? The question is that how one can design where the disease response material possible. So, and people have been, like, working on to identify the biomarkers specific to inflammation, and they have identified that, like, a series of proteolytic enzymes highly overexpressed during inflammation like conditions. Then technically, if you develop a material which, in the absence of these enzymes, if they remain stable in the body, don't release the drug, But when these enzymes comes, then they should be able to degrade. Then we might be able to achieve the enzyme responsive or disease responsive like delivery. So the conceptual approach, what we take is like we design these small molecular amplifiers. These are like lipid-like molecules which have the ability to self-assemble to form nanomaterials. And during the self-assembly process, one can encapsulate these drugs. And these drugs, they not specifically, they don't get released. But when they get exposed to the enzymes that are associated with inflammation, can degrade this and release the drug. So that's the overall concept what we are taking. And the question comes, what amplifier one should take it, right? Because by using organic chemistry, one can design very novel molecules. Don't know what would the later on clinical toxicity we are going to face it. So because of that, what we thought is like, we already select the molecules which has already been used in human and which is known to be safe. So the FDA has a list of compounds called GRAS agents, which are already known to be safe. So we screened almost a couple of hundred of molecules and narrowed down to 4 molecules which have the ability to form this self-assembled material. One of them is triglyceryl monostearate, a simple amplifier, and which has the ability to self-assemble, but not only that, because of the having this ester bond, this can be in a responsive manner, it can be degraded by enzymes. And we optimize condition to form the self-assembled hydrogels, and we take the tacrolimus, which is known immunosuppressants and prescribed immunosuppressants in here, and we optimize conditions to encapsulate into this injectable hydrogel. And then we tested their ability to release the drug in response to the enzymes. As you see here, in the absence of enzymes, they have a 5 to 10% of non-specific release. After that, it stabilizes. In fact, we tested up to 3 months, you don't see that non-specific release. But in the presence of a series of proteolytic enzymes, it can degrade and release the drug. But these are like highly purified, stabilized enzymes, right? Then we wanted to see whether inflammatory-like system also can do the same job. So to do that, like we take the macrophages and you activate these immune cells by treating lipopolysaccharide. And your activated macrophages resemble serial inflammatory-like condition. They are known to produce proteolytic enzymes as well. Then we wanted to see this in-situ generated proteolytic enzymes also can do the job, right? So to test that, we take the condition media either from activated and non-activated condition macrophages and expose to these gels to see the release of the drug. As you can see, when they expose to the non-activated condition media from these macrophages, the release was similar to the buffer, right? But when you expose these gels to the activated macrophages condition media, we can see the release of the drug. Not only that, when you give the fresh pulses of this activated condition media, you see the dose responsive manner. Suggesting that this material has the ability to release the drug in an inflammation responsive manner, and also the level of inflammation can fuel the release of the drug. So once we have that, we went and tested their ability to protect the transplanted organs. And then we took the completely mismatched rats and did the entire limb transplantation from Brown Narve rats to Lewis rat. And the post-transplantation, you can take these injectable hydrogels and keep them at a subcutaneous depot, and you measure the level of or the survival graph. Right? Just to summarize quickly results, post-transplantation, for example, if you don't give any treatment or give only gel without having any drugs, and their median survival time was 11 days, like 50% of the animals rejected the drug in 11 days. And as a control, you take the drug, and without encapsulating into the gel, you do the local injection of the drug. And in that case, again, within 33 days, again, you can see a rejection of the graft, and you see the eyelid tissue damage and inflammation, and so on. Now, the same amount of drug, if you take and encapsulate into the gel and inject them, now, even if after 100 days, you don't see the sign of rejection and it grows back, and animal actually gains its function, now it's able to move it on. And we also extensively tested their systemic immune system that is still active, and there is no non-specific organ toxicity, because when you take the oral medication like that, these are highly renal toxic compounds, because most of the hand transplantation for patients, they come back with the renal failure. So, but because of this local systemic immunosuppression, and there is no systemic toxicity of these drugs. So, and then we wanted to see like how long we can protect these drugs, right? So for example, if you give the single dose of this drug, and only drug, and you know, survival was only 33 days, but the same dose if you give just the single injection, the survival kicked to 190. And we have done the extensive pharmacokinetics to see the how long drug is available and so on. So based on that, if you do the periodic injections, like you know, post-transplantation, day one injection, after 3 months you give second injection, you know, survival went to 260. And without having any systemic toxicity, so on, which is clearly suggesting that if you have these periodic injections of these gels, one can protect the transplanted organ until the animal is alive without causing any side effects. But more importantly, then we wanted to see whether having this localized immune suppression versus whole systemic immune suppression can be in patients, right? So for that, you take the two groups of transplanted animals, and one group received these periodic injections of the gels, and four times in 280 days, but other group received the oral administration of tacrolimus. The graft survival is same in both cases, but more importantly, if you see the animals received this oral therapy, all of them developed opportunistic infection, whereas when you have the localized immune suppression, so, which is clearly suggesting the advantage of having this disease-responsive localized aerogels for the protecting transplanted organs. So after showing efficacy in the small animals, we went and showed their efficacy in larger animals as well. Now we are in the process of setting up a clinical trial to go to the human. So with that, it will bring to the second example where how we can use this disease-responsive of inflammatory arthritis. As you know, arthritis is primarily affects all your joints, and people have to take this anti-inflammatory agents in a systemic manner. And in order to have the efficiency, people have to take large doses, but they comes with a plethora of side effects, right? So because of that, you know, there are multiple drugs like Vioxx and Bextra were called up from the market by FDA. So to overcome this systemic toxicity, people started doing intra-articular injections directly into the joints, right? But unfortunately, it wasn't also not very successful, because if you see the amount of residence time that drugs remain there in the joints is very poor. A series of drugs have tried these intra-articular injections. I think like, you know, 0.5 hours to like, you know, 5 hours time, they remain there, they diffuse out. So, and according to protocols, you cannot take more than 5 injections in a year. Otherwise, we end up damaging the cartilage and so on. So then as an alternative method, people started taking and injecting or encapsulating into a variety of biomaterials like, you know, nanoparticles, microparticles, hydrogels, and so on. But unfortunately, it wasn't also very successful. As I mentioned, like, you know, your inflammation is highly sporadic. And like, you know, despite whether you have the inflammation or not, these biomaterials continuously, they the drug for a couple of weeks and gone, right? That's why like therapeutic outcome was very poor. So that's where we thought like having this inflammation response material might be better. So for that, again, we took the triamcinolone acetonate, and which again encapsulated and optimized into developing the injectable hydrogels. And this for, again, we showed that this has the ability to release the drug in response to the enzymes and also for the inflammation. So on, then more importantly, we wanted to see whether the synovial fluid in arthritis patients do have this inflamed, right? So then we wanted to see if inflamed synovial fluid also can release the drug in a responsive manner. So to test that, we collected the synovial fluid from arthritis patients as well as in healthy volunteers and exposed to the gels to see the release of the drug. As you shown here, you know, when you have the synovial fluid from the healthy volunteers, the release of the drug is similar to the buffer. That means there is no enhanced release. But whereas the synovial fluid that was collected from the arthritis patients have the much higher release of the drug. Not only that, when you give the fresh bolus of this inflamed synovial fluid, can induce higher release of the drug, which is clearly suggesting that having this. And also one more point is like. Our hypothesis was like when you have the inflammation, they release the proteolytic enzymes, right? So that's the reason why you see the inflammation. So to test that, you take the MMP inhibitors, these enzyme inhibitors, add to this inflammatory fluid, and in that case, again, it drops the release. So which is clearly suggesting that having this inflammation in the synovial fluid also can, you know, responsive manner can release the drug. So the another important point we wanted to see is like, so in the absence of inflammation, can they remain there like where the site of injections and don't release the drug, right? And whenever inflammation comes, can they release the drug in an on-demand manner? So to test that, we took these fluorescently labeled hydrogels and inject them into the joints. Even a couple of weeks, we don't see the depletion of signal and so on. Having their, you know, knee movement, they don't release the drug and they remain there. But now you can induce the mild arthritis by injecting this serum. It's a KBX in serum for 37 microliters, which is known to induce the mild arthritis after 4th or 6th day. And as you can see here, and after 6 days, you see the depletion of the serum. And this can also be accelerated by injecting double dose of your serum, and which induces the severe arthritis from day 2 onwards. So in that case, like when you inject double dose of serum, you can see after 4 days, depletion of this gel sandwich. Which is clearly suggesting that this material has the ability to remain localized if there is no inflammation. And whenever inflammation comes, they can release the drug in on-demand manner. So after we went and tested their overall therapeutic outcome based on this disease-responsive materials. And as you can see, one way to measure this arthritis is measuring the swelling of the palp. As you can see, like when you have free drug, compared to free drug injection into the joints and the same dose when you encapsulate into the gel, you have much better therapeutic outcome. Even when you measure the clinical score, you see the same. So in a nutshell, like having this inflammation response might be having the much better therapeutic outcome from the treatment of arthritis by doing the local injection. So with that, I would like to come to the third example where to add like one more layer of the design. Not only inflammation responsive, but it is inflammation pathway limiting, right? So, because if you see the IBDs, inflammatory body cells, it comes in two variants, you know, Crohn's disease and colitis. The Crohn's, like we have large intestine and small intestine, both of them are affected, but whereas in colitis, you have the large intestine is affected. And, but if you see, these are like the patches of inflammation you have throughout the colon, right? And today, there is no way to deliver the drug only at the site of inflammation. The drug, whatever you take, even your healthy tissue also get the same dose of drug, right? And irony is that like the side effects of these drugs are causing ulcers. So basically, you're treating ulcer tissue, but like healthy tissue is becoming ulcer. So that's one of the reasons you don't have any efficient therapy for IBDs. So ideal way of treating this this patient would be like having a drug delivery system which is stable in the entire GI tract. But whenever we have the site of inflammation, they should go and bind specifically to the inflamed tissue and release the drug. In that way, like only inflamed tissue gets the drug, but your healthy tissue never sees the drug. So in that way, one can eliminate all the side effects. The question is how that can be possible to induce adherence to only site of inflammation, right? If you see the, wherever you have the inflammation, right, like as a defense mechanism, our body produces this high concentration of antibacterial peptides and bacterial sites, right? So all of them, they're cationic in nature. These are cationic peptides, right? Because of that, your entire tissue where you have inflamed is a cationic charge peptide. That's where it is either neutral or negative, right? So then we thought, can we use a simple covalent interactions as a means to direct the induce the specific adherence. For example, if you take the nanoparticles, which are complementary in charge and which they in entire GI tract, so because of this anionic cationic interaction, they can go and specifically bind to the only site of inflammation or ulcerative tissue that they have, and your local inflammation can kick in and release the drug. Right. So that's the overall concept of what we have been developing. So again, we selected like a small molecules. These are another amphiphile, and it can self-assemble and encapsulate the drug. There's a methadone. This is like this drug for colitis. But like in addition to self-assemble, it also should really contains a partially negative surface charge because the overall particles will become negative surface charge. This also should have the ability to release the drug in a response to the proteolytic enzymes. And the amplifier, what we selected, what Pascal will permit it, because it also does contain a Then we went and characterized extensively the nanofiber they formulated. All of them are highly negative surface charge, so that they can find processes. Then again, we showed that they are inflammation responsive and they can release drugs and so on. And then we wanted to see that, you know, the proteins that are overexpressed at the site of inflammation have the ability to bind these particles. So for that, we took the transferrin, which is overexpressed at the site of inflamed tissue, and coated with this plates, and also as a control, we took the mucin, which is a normal tissue, and you encapsulate this dice into these fibers and you know incubate with these plates and wash them extensively, and you can see, you know, it's a logical, right? Having cationic anionic interaction, you see the only specific adherence when you have the transferrin. Then the question is, can we extend the same concept? Right? So to test that, like you take the normal animals, and if you give them dextran sodium sulfate for 7 days, and they develop the colitis, and they now colon becomes inflamed. Now you take these fibers and give them to NMRs, and after 24 hours, you know, surgically you can remove the colons and see how much of fibers these are attached, right? And as you can see here, in wild-type animal where no disease is there, we can't see a traces of any fluorescent signal. That means that since we have the high bowel movement, all the fibers, they are complicated. But whereas when you have the diseased colon or like an inflamed colon, you can see high amount of fibers are attached by having this large bowel movement, which is clearly suggesting that this material has the ability to go and adhere to the site of inflammation and release the drug. Then after that, like, we went and tested to the overall therapeutic outcome. As you can see, the drug that was given freely versus drug encapsulated into this targeted nanoparticle has much better therapeutic outcome. Then the question comes, like, although you can see it in the mirror model, say it works very well, whether it has the ability to specifically adhere to the human. Is that you take what we have done is through biopsies we collected the tissue from inflamed colon versus from the same patient, collected and healthy tissue also from this colitis patient, and ex vivo you incubate this fiber with this tissue and extensively wash it to see whether they have. As you can see, these fibers have much better adherence to the inflamed tissue versus a normal tissue of the patient. And individually, if you analyze, like for example, if this patient's healthy tissue has X amount of adherence, from the same patients where you have the inflamed tissue, adherence is much higher. And the same trend we have observed for every single patient. So which is clearly suggesting that this material might be able to adhere specifically to the inflamed tissue and release that. So these are the examples what we have shown for developing therapeutic biomaterials. And I quickly go through our second example where how we can design prophylactic materials for biomedical applications. in this case, like, we are developing materials for protecting or like preventing pesticide-induced toxicity and lethality in farmers, right? Because you all know, like, the pesticides are neurotoxins and they are designed to kill pests. Typically, what happens, like, you know, you have this acetylcholine esterase enzyme, which plays a major role in neuromuscular by controlling neurotransmitter acetylcholine. And all the pesticides are designed to go and covalently bind to this enzyme and inhibit its function. So when quantitatively inhibit this function, that leads to your entire neurotoxicity and paralyzes pests and that. But unfortunately, these chemicals, they do not discriminate between pests and humans. When you get exposed to the human, like, they have the same toxicity, right? And typically, if you see all the farmers today, like how they spray pesticides or following, right? Like, you know, typically they use these motorized pumps and they spray without having any protection. And during that this process, people get exposed to through dermal and inhalation. right? And that leads to the severe toxicity. But like the conventional literature, what you suggest is like, you know, people have to get exposed like in several years, and like over a period of decades, they might start seeing the symptoms. But we thought like, you know, we wanted to understand ground reality to see what is the real scenario rather than from the literature. So for that, we went and launched a survey, like almost 8 months we spent in Telangana state, and to understand like what kind of pesticide they use, do they use it? They have any side effects. And that was like actually eye-opener for us, because instead of the chronic effects, in addition to chronic effects, the acute toxicity is very high. The same day when they spray pesticide, from same evening onwards, they see after depending upon the level of exposure, they have like vomiting, diarrhea, high fever, muscle constriction, convulsions, and tremors. And like, just to give an example, like, you know, a couple of years back, like, within span of 3 months, like, you know, there are like 60 people lost their lives and thousands got exposed to the pesticides while spraying in cotton fields. And this is all from one district in Maharashtra, right? That shows the level of need that is there and the lack of any technologies to protect this. That's why we thought we develop some of the technologies to protect these farmers. As I mentioned, all these pesticides have this high skin penetration power. They can easily go through them and inhibit these enzymes. So our idea is to develop a topical gel which can be used like your skin gel before they spray, you apply that. And this gel, like a physical barrier, they don't work because they're a bit high for physical barriers, but like these are highly skin penetration power. That's why you want to develop a chemical scissor like active gels. So, which means like it remains there, which can go and covalently break down this all the pesticide into non-harmful products, which can no longer can inhibit the overall concept what we are taking. So the idea is like if you see all the pesticides, they all of them are shared one common structure. These are activated esters. All of them are activated esters. Then we wanted to use the simple fundamental nucleophile hydrolysis concept, where you can develop a catalyst which can break down these esters into acids, which can no longer can inhibit them. So for that, like we took a class of compounds called supernucleophiles or alpha nucleophiles, and which can be used for designing this. So there are various kind of molecules are known to have this supernucleophile properties. We selected oxime. Instead of going into details, what we have done is like we selected as a polyoxime compound. If you take only nucleophile, it can go through the skin. So that's why we attach to a polymer, so that this polymer can no longer go penetrate into the skin. And now this can go and, you know, break down all the pesticides. And not only that, it can act as a catalytic, and it can regenerate and start break down more compounds. So this is the chemical scheme, like a simple. And you can formulate them into a topical gel. As a control, we took just a polymer which doesn't have the ability to break down, chemical breakdown, and that is your control gel. Then after, like, we went and tested its ability to prevent the pesticide-induced ACH inhibition. For example, if when you have this Franz diffusion cell, at the bottom chamber, you can take this animal blood, which contains your acetylcholinesterase enzymes. Add your pesticide from there, if you are like either directly exposed or the control gel or your active gel. And if you measure the enzyme activity here, right, in the absence of pesticide, you know, you have 100% enzyme activity. But when they expose either directly or in the presence of your control gel, you can see the significant drop of the enzyme activity. But whereas when you have the active gel, you don't see that, which is clearly suggesting that this gel has the ability to break down the pesticide is used. Now that we went and tested its ability to prevent this ACH inhibition in vivo, for that, like, you know, we take three groups of animals, like they get little dose of this pesticide either directly or in the presence of controller active gel, right? And then if you measure the level of enzyme activity, as you can see, when they received either directly or control gel, you can see a significant drop of enzyme activity. But whereas in the presence of your active gel, you don't see. Not only in the blood, if you see the systemic, like in the tissue, for example, in brain also, you see the similar trend. having protective active gel is completely prevented a lot. And in every single tissue, you see a similar trend what we observe. So then we wanted to see whether, because all these farmers, they keep getting re-exposed, right? Then we wanted to see and prevent the re-exposure as well. So for that, again, three groups of animals were taken, and all of them, they received every single day repeated dose of this pesticide for 4 days, either directly or in the presence of this control and active gels. Here, every time you apply pesticide, exposed pesticide, you apply a fresh gel coating. In that case, if you see animals that received either directly or control gel, all of them, they lost their lives within 6 days. But whereas when you have the active gel, all of them survived and 100% survived. And again, if you measure the level of enzyme activity, you can clearly see it's a complete loss of activity when you directly expose completely. Then we wanted to see, because if you see the farmers, right, whether we can have the catalytic manner or how often these farmers should apply, right? With a single layer, if you apply, will it be enough for the entire day of exposure? So to test that, what we have done is, again, we expose this animal 4 days continuously. But instead of every day applying your gel, only the day one, one time they have applied the gel. And on the same gels, you repeatedly expose twice and see the survival. In that case, again, you can see a control gel completely. Control gel lost their life within 6 days. But whereas active gel completely prevented such. So this is clearly suggesting that even having a single application, as long as it is there on the top of skin, it can completely break down the pesticides in a catalytic manner to protect. As you know, farmers field work needs high physical activity, and since this enzyme plays a major role in neuromuscular functions when they get exposed, it leads to the loss of their muscle function, loss of their function. Wanted to see whether we can prevent such loss of muscle functions. To do that, we took the rotor rod experiment. This is experiment for animals. You measure how long they can run on this rotor rod, and you measure their muscle function based on that. So you train them, all these animals, for 4 days, and after the training period over, one group of animals receives either directly the pesticide or in the presence of active gel. One group they don't receive at all. So again, after that, you measure again their neuromuscular function. As you can see, the animals they directly exposed, they completely lost their ability to do any muscle function, completely lost. But whereas in the presence pesticide they received in the presence of active gel, they continue. As we did, animals, they never received the pesticide. So that clearly suggests that it has the ability to prevent the neuromuscular loss of function. And another important point is even small dose of pesticide exposure leads to neuronal damage. So we want to see whether we can prevent such. So one way to measure is quantifying the sciatic nerve damage. The sciatic nerve damage plays a major role in your limb movement. So one way to measure this is through gait analysis. You color code animal paws and make them walk on this mesh, and you can measure the distance between their toes and the angle they take the step. So on, there's an equation to put all these numbers together, and you measure something called sciatic functional index. And typically, this SFI comes. If there is no internal neuronal damage in healthy animals, you always get between 11 to minus 11. That's the values you get. Anything below minus 20 considered as severe neuronal damage. So the wild type animals, before exposure, you can see all of them comes into this safe range. But when they get directly exposed, you can see a severe damage of cardiac nerve damage. But whereas in the presence, same dose of pesticide that got exposed in the presence of this active gel completely prevented. So one more, as I mentioned, this enzyme works by controlling your neurotransmitter, acetylcholine at the connection. So when the enzyme gets inhibited, you have the accumulation of this neurotransmitter. That means you have continuous active signal. Even if you don't want to have the active signal, you're always firing, right? So to measure that, for example, this is a healthy volunteer, never got exposed to pesticides. If you measure the neuronal signal between these two muscles, you don't see it because there is no active movement, right? So because of that, you don't see the signaling. But like same way, if you measure to the farmer, like who got exposed to the pesticide, and although like again, like he's not really moving his hand, and you can see the firing of the neurons. So that's the reason when they get exposed, they have this severe uncontrolled movements and tremors. Then we wanted to see whether we can prevent such uncontrolled movements. So one way to do is like measure the electromyogram readings. For example, these animals, so if you put them under anesthesia and you measure the neuronal signaling between this hand, limb, biceps and femoris, and you know, this naive animals, you don't see any signal, but when you get directly exposed, you can see a. But the same dose of pesticide exposure in the presence of polyethylene gel is completely prevented. And not only under anesthesia, if you keep them in a awake, because once you get exposed, it leads to the stress. Now the animals start moving rapidly. Because of that, you have now active and or voluntary and involuntary movement. That's why you see a rapid firing of these signals. But the same dose exposure in the presence of active gel completely. So, which overall it clearly suggests that like having this dermal key, one can protect or prevent the pesticide exposure and all the associated toxicity. But if you think about the practical point of view, right? Applying this gel every single time, all of the body going to the field, you know, farmers might not come. So, that's why an ideal way to have a another way of protection, that is, we thought like, you know, the we can just wear the suit or have the mask, which can completely right. So again, just normal clothes, they don't work because your regular carbon plastics absorbs more pesticides and keep them as a depot. We have much more exposure than without clothes. So that's why this cloth should have the ability to again degrade, chemically deactivate all the pesticides. So that's the concept what we have developed. Again, we have designed another new molecule and which can which has the ability to break down the pesticide, but now that can covalently attach to the fabric. Now we have the activated fabric, which can be stitched into gowns and a mask. Right? So again, once we developed that, we went and tested their ability, as I mentioned before. Here, instead of gel, now we keep the fabric, as you can see. You know, either direct exposure or through a controlled fabric, non-activated fabric, did not prevent the enzyme loss of enzyme activity. But when you have the active fabric, it's completely prevented. And this is how we can generate the suits. These are activated cloth-based suits. And similarly for the animals also we have developed. Now, animal can receive the pesticide through this cloth, either activated or direct cloth. And if you measure the level of toxicity after exposing them, as you can see in the blood, when you have the direct exposure or the exposure through normal cloth, completely loss of activity also. But whereas when you have the active cloth, clothing, it's completely. And not only just internal toxicity, but we measure the internal neuronal damage also, it can completely prevent it. Even the repeated exposure toxicity also, if you measure, can completely prevent the loss of activity. And that is through dermal route, right? Then the question is, can we prevent through inhalation process as well? So to do that, like we built this box where you can fill this entire chamber with the pesticide aerosol, and you can keep your animals here and put your cloth here, so they move the cloth. So this is how you fill your entire pesticide aerosol into the box. Now, if the three groups of animals, either they directly breathe your pesticide or they breathe through normal cloth or the activated. That case also, if you see, the animals, they breathe through activated cloth, completely protected from as direct cloth, or is a non-activated cloth. So, in a nutshell, like having this protective measurement, one can prevent the pesticide exposure. And regarding this dermal thing, like we have just completed all the studies, our idea is to go to the DGCI. And having this both dermal herbal treat and cloth together, our aim is to protect every single farmers in India and also developing countries. So just to summarize all our effort, like, you know, in the therapeutic biomaterials, having this disease response biomaterial one could help or prevent the rejection episodes in the transplanted organs and increase the therapeutic arthritis and IBDs. In the prophylactic biomaterials, we could able to show that having this dermal and the protective care one can prevent the rest. Today I couldn't talk about our efforts in the novel chemical entities there, but like we also been working actively to develop the small molecular drugs to protect all the efficient therapeutics for the treatment of rheumatoid arthritis. So with that, I would like to stop here, and I would like to thank all the people who did the work here. Like, these are the PhDs and postdocs and research interns from my lab, and these are the group of people who work in hydrogel platform and IBDs and antibodies platform. And like, I'm blessed with a wonderful collaborators. Like, these are like right of the hand transplantation surgeons and like all IBD and so on from various part of the country, and I'd like to thank funding sources, various funding.